Welcome to the funnest webinar you've attended in the past 3 weeks, possibly 3 years, possibly three lifetimes.
Forever. We are
so excited to be here. As you can tell, me and Anne don't get along at all. This is super exciting. I am not in New Orleans, as it may look. Sorry to disappoint. I am with my beautiful picture behind me. I needed to move my desk to get the right light. I'm a little side lit here. And you look gorgeous today.
You're so sweet, but I am in my office. So with my books, my dog scratching at the door, I'm ready to go.
Well, and you look all nice and dressed up. I'm sitting here in my Noteflight t-shirt trying to represent Noteflight, and you're all fancy. I didn't know this was I was going more for quarantine casual. You're more of like quarantine business.
QC code. Yeah, no, I'm quarantined. Yeah, I'm good from the neck up or from the waist up.
We all are at this time, right? Yeah, I'll admit I'm wearing sweatpants. Not going to lie. Work from home.
So TMI.
Welcome, everyone. We're all here. We're comfortable. We're ready to talk about Noteflight. This is a very exciting webinar to get into. As we promised, we're going to have 10 tips and at least 50, if not 60 or 70 lessons. If anyone wants to count the number of lessons we're going to throw out, we can do that too. That'll be a fun game. Like, how many jello beans are in this jar? How many lessons we actually get to.
And also, I'm going to say that if we have an idea, I bet it's going to spur an idea on your part too. So get your pencil out, take notes on your computer. And because when we start talking about a few things, it's going to make you think of your classroom and the extensions and connections you'll have for it as well.
I love it. So without further ado, the whole purpose of this is, I know we're all trying to get something for our students to do right away. So let's get started with the first tip on how to use this, which is basically we're going to open up Noteflight Learn. Now, this starts with having a Noteflight Learn account with students added. So we can help you if you need to get to that point. I'm in my Noteflight Learn account right now, and I'm sharing my screen. You can see it. So now I'm going to simply go to the library section. I'm going to pull in an existing Noteflight Learn library score. I just clicked on that. And we're going to pull up a theory exercise, and you have an entire library of existing content. And I'm going to pull up basic theory. How about number 2, natural minor scales? Now, everything in the library is available to all teachers and students. You can check out a copy here. So I've just checked out a copy, and suddenly it's going to copy this exercise into my Noteflight account. So I think the easiest thing to do for tip 1 here is to take something that exists in the Noteflight Learn library and you can assign it to your students right away. Now, I'll show you just on this first lesson how to assign to your students. Every activity and every lesson we come up with today, you'll have to give your students access. And the way you do that every time is go to Score Details and go down to the Share panel. And you can share score with, easiest thing to do is all site members. This simply gives access to anyone that has access to your Noteflight Learn site can open this score. And so this is the easiest way to get this going. And then you'll go all the way down to the bottom and hit activity template. This means when you send this to a student, they're opening their own unique copy. So the easiest thing to do here every time is share score, all site, top checkbox, go all the way to the bottom checkbox, and you're done. If you're a Google Classroom integrated user, you will see the option to create a Google Classroom assignment. It'll look different, but you'll still have the same opportunity. So if you're Google Classroom, you'll make a Google Classroom assignment, but that's separate than this. So now I've saved, and now this is a link. I can send this link, or I can add it to Google Classroom or my LMS, and I can send it to my students to complete, and ta-da, they're ready to go. Tip number 1. Use something that's existing and get going right away. Anne, what do you think?
Well, this is fantastic. You could also think of the scales that you're studying with your students or a piece of music that they have. And if it's in a particular minor scale, make sure you're picking that minor scale and so they're applying it. You could add measures underneath and then maybe even change the key signatures so you have the relative major to it and they can compare contrast. Or you can add another one. You could actually do the parallel minor to it or the parallel major to it. And they can compare and contrast the whole notes and half notes. The cool thing is you can actually give them this and say, okay, now that you know this scale, let's do some written comparison contrast to this other scale, and or they can even start to compose in it. So they can take whatever term you're studying in music theory or an understanding of a scale application, invite them to apply the information immediately. So it's not just like a worksheet, they're just filling in the answers and checking with their friends online somewhere and sharing with a picture. That way it gives everyone a possible extension and it can further them as individual musicians.
Another
thing you could do is take that scale and maybe create another staff underneath it. Maybe it's a piano staff, and then they could create chords to go along with it. Maybe they could add a drone and they could see how the tension and release increases or decreases depending on the actual pitch that is on there. So don't take it as just a single frame and it's a single worksheet. Add and expand.
Perfect. So you can take any of these existing worksheets and you can easily notice, as I took Anne's idea of let's do the parallel majors. So I did C major, I changed this. These are Noteflight scores. You can edit these up. So you could create this as a quick variation here, and then you can make different variations. The other thing I'll share, and this is all part of tip one, so this is only the beginning, is that not only sharing as an activity template, but you can make copies of anything in Noteflight very easily. So let's say you assigned this to your students, and you maybe change the name to C minor and major fun, because everything is fun, right, Anne?
Absolutely, it should be fun and exciting and engaging, because we want to engage our students in everything we do.
That's exactly it. Minor, major, fun. So now, in the score menu of Noteflight, you can actually save a copy of anything, and it's this icon right up here. So I could just make a, so let's say I've assigned C minor and major fun to my students. Great, so let me make a copy, and we're gonna go ahead, yes, it's making sure it wants me to know to reload the page. Thanks, Chrome. So it made a copy of this. So now this is a whole new score I can use. Now I could call this maybe C, oh, what's more fun than C major? C sharp minor and major. So now, because everything's better with hashtags when learning from home. Am I right?
You know what? I think we should take a picture of that and put that on Instagram. Hashtag that.
Good. What are we going to hashtag it?
Hashtag C sharp, or just put C sharp minor.
Hashtag sharp. And with Noteflight, I'm just editing these notes up to then it's done. Yes, I know the difference between a hashtag and a sharp, so I don't need people sending me their don't at me. I know. But yeah, exactly. So we can make extensions of all of these. So again, immediate ways to get your student engaged.
Okay. And, John, I'm going to jump in here. Okay. Wouldn't that be so cool for them to take C sharp minor scale and maybe compose either a known tune? I'm going to revert to Twinkle Twinkle, but whatever you want. Compose Twinkle Twinkle in C sharp minor and then copy and paste that and drag it into C sharp major. Wouldn't that be fantastic? Or you can just change the half steps. So they can hear it between the two and they can compare contrast those half steps.
Absolutely. Like as Anne said, I'm just changing the instructions. Again, this is a copy of the assignment. We can make extensions of this. These are ready to go. But again, make these work for your kids and personalize them. These are just idea starters. The whole purpose of this content library is that any one of these can be adapted in hundreds of ways to be used right away. So I think this is perfectly, perfectly easy to just get going right away. All right.
One last thing. Go to the next tip, and that is ask your students to change it up. Don't give them the directive to say, hey, here's the first part, here are the first two measures. You tell me what you want to do with this. Let's open it up, and then it'll differentiate in a way that everyone's going to find themselves in it.
I love it. So now tip two is an extension of existing content. By the way, the first five tips are all using existing content as it is today. So I'm going to go back into my home here. Let's go back into the libraries. And now I want to grab in the library, again, everyone has access to this in Noteflight Learn. Let's grab a melody. There's a bunch of different melodies, common melodies, and we can just grab one of these and get going. So I'm going to start with, I'm just looking down here and seeing what's there, scrolling so everyone can see. I'll scroll slower so we can see. I think there's some Brahms in here. Yes. How about some Brahms and B-flat? What's better than Brahms and B-flat? So again,
major. Okay.
Exactly. There's a joke in there somewhere. Uh, I'm the trumpet player that's been on the orchestra, so that's I have that melody once and I get to blast. You know what's great about playing trumpet, Anne, is
what's
I'm
that?
So good at trumpet that every conductor I've ever played for has given me a virtual high five as I play. Sometimes they give me two. I'm like, I must be doing great. High five. Great. Thanks, conductor. Every conductor gives me high fives while I play.
It's all
amazing.
Perspective, John. It's all perspective.
That's how I know I'm doing well. So, all right. So here's a Brahms melody. I mean, you have these existing tunes, so students can just play this, right? I mean, that's immediate option. And so because it's a Noteflight, I'll show you the parts panel up here. This defaults to a piano part, but you can take this pin and you can change it. So let's say I want to play it. How about the trumpet? The most glorious of all instruments. So I'm going to make this a trumpet. Now, one tip as a teacher when you do this is, you know, Noteflight defaults to concert pitch, which is up here in the left. So what you want to do is just go and say, you know what, let me turn concert pitch off so it'll transpose. And make sure if you do that before you send this to your students, so then all they have to do is say, nope, I want to do this on the alto sax. All I got to do is slap a reed and blow. Just kidding, alto saxophone players. I know it's harder than that. Or maybe I want to do this on the oboe. Let's get it back into regular key, right? So let's play it a quarter tone flat. Aha, just kidding, oboe players. You know what? Let's put it back for clarinet. I'll switch it to clarinet. Now let's just play it about 10 cents flat, right? So there we go. Just kidding, clarinet players. No one's safe, by the way. So again, this can be played and played right away.
Okay. We could also take this and make it a transposition exercise. Just as we talked about that earlier, you can move it up and maybe invite the students to add the half steps or make a half step lower and different scale steps of the scale so they can find that. And you can make it minor. You can transpose it to a different key completely on the major side. You could even take and make this a variation. You could add trills to it. You could add ornamentation to it. You could invite them to listen to Twinkle Twinkle, the many variations of Twinkle Twinkle, and then using that technique, they could actually compose variations on the theme from Symphony No. 1. So they could have variation 1 and 2, and maybe just take the main first melodic line. Another thing you could do is delete half the melody of the first phrase and then ask them to complete the answer to the original question. So you start supporting phrase understandings of question and answer, and then see all the different variations to that. I see John's doing that right now for you. John, go for it.
Yeah, so I'm going to make this super simple. I've kind of just deleted some measures and now I've just kind of made it a little simpler exercise. So yeah, this can be a, hey, what would you do for the next four or five measures of Brahms? You know, that's a perfect example. I'll show you another trick here. What Anne mentioned is that this text menu, there's a great little option here called show prompt. And so on the existing exercises, this is where a lot of the instructions are. Show prompt enables this little prompt. And then this is like a text box where you can type instructions just like this. Now, the cool thing is you can type, you can hit enter and type more as you go, and then it'll just kind of format it all out for you. So in this case, you can make this however you want it. You can adapt this melody and say, complete the last four bars. I know I have five empty bars, and I know I forgot my P in complete, but other than that, we're doing real well, y'all.
You know what, John, maybe as you're doing this, this made me think, what about they could show the first complete melody and then the little bit of space, and then they show the first half of the melody and they complete it, and then they could talk about how it's different. So it's, oh, by like theory terms, they can say, oh, it's a step lower or a step higher. And then this would get them doing some cool compare contrast work too. You could easily add another staff. So then you have two staves and you get to create harmony to it.
So this I'd go in part. And so I made this a flute part. So let's put it.
Best of all instruments, just let's be clear, flute.
Half of your air goes out of your horn. Half of your air doesn't even go in your instrument. How is it even a real instrument, okay? Literally, flute is nothing but overtones for trumpets in the orchestra. Prove me wrong.
Oh my gosh.
It just fills in the overtones and the nice little wiggly moments.
If you're on the comment side of this chat or this webinar, please leave a comment about how great flute players are. Thanks.
Insulted woodwinds, and don't worry, trombone players are next. So yeah, there's no. So I added an oboe part here. And again, you can, you know, here's one thing I like to do. I'm just going to select this and command copy just like I would in a Word doc. And I'm going to select this and paste. So It copies the same notes here, and I can delete the text. What I like to do is tell students, you know what, make a counter melody by just moving the notes up and down. So maybe you could do something like this. And you could do something here that's kind of
John. Right? Yeah, John, that's a great idea, because then you could go from a counter melody. You could even say, you know, here comes polyphony, right? Can you create an independent melodic line that stands on its own in comparison to the first one? So you can really show them what polyphony is in that, because that's really challenging for students to do. They want to make harmony and they think that that's an independent melodic line. But if they really want to go for the higher theory work, that'd be cool.
Right. So I'm just going to kind of show, I'm just using the arrows left and right. Ta-da. And then we have a little, and they can know, and students will know what things sound like. So they can play and listen to these together. We'll go back to the beginning. So I don't like that D. We can do something else. Maybe we can do E flat there. See what that sounds like.
And then
that's kind of cool.
And then, John, they can record themselves on the new part they composed.
Oh, yeah. We're going to talk about recording, too. So lots of opportunities for here. But the idea is, like, how many different ways can we take an existing melody and just repurpose it to make what we've look, we said 5 tips. That was like 12 tips. I mean, okay, I can't even.
But we've got one more before we can go on. And that is, if you have like a beat, an A section to the melody, then why don't you create like an add a percussion break or add a B section that's going to be totally different, and then create an ABA. So it'd be like the main melody is A, and then the B section is a percussion break or a place for other instruments to take solo, and then come back to the A section again.
So perfect example, I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna hit R to just repeat, and I added 4 empty measures, and I'm gonna just shift select what I have here, copy, shift select, paste, and there you go. There's your A, and there's your A again, and there's your middle section for the instruction. So that's exactly what Anne was talking about, right? Copy, paste, and again, in Noteflight, anything you select, you can use the R key. In Boston, we say ah. In New Orleans, it's more like R. In Baton Rouge, it's R. But however you want to use it, the R key for repeat, y'all. So, yeah, I've lived in Baton Rouge and Boston, so I can't say anything right. You know, I'm such a mix of accents. I'm like, Pakika, y'all. Like, it makes no sense. Like,
right.
Anyway, you know what? Let's go back to Noteflight, because we are 2 tips in and 20 minutes in, and we got to get through this in an hour. Okay, so now, third tip, make the notation editor a learning lesson, right? And so the one thing is that we try to remember is, like, how do you use Noteflight? Well, make a learning lesson out of that. So now you have all these palettes on the left, and the way Noteflight is organized is you have a menu on the left here, and you have all these editor palettes, and anything that's checked or anything you select will pin to the top. In addition, you have parts, as we've already shown. We have formatting, which you can change the sizing of all the text and stuff. If you just stick to parts, formatting, and all of the editor options, you could gamify just getting used to learning Noteflight, right? So, like, here's an idea, like, make it like, here's an existing melody, I'll use what we're already on. Use something from 3 or more of the palettes on the left that you've never heard of, and just see how it works. You know, and let students experiment. So yeah, let's add a dynamic here. Let's add a crescendo to this, and let's go over here. Let's add an ornament. Let's add a trill to it. How does a trill work? You know, I can trill on trumpet.
But we don't,
I don't know how to end a trill. You know how a trumpet player ends a trill? They run out of breath.
That's right. We don't want to hear that, because the trills are made for flute. Let's just be clear.
Well, that's true.
Okay. So hey, let's talk about this for a second, because we could take these terms from this, all of those menu items, and what if you invite the students to categorize these by the elements of music, like dynamics, and they have to go through and add crescendo and decrescendo, and I mean that could be like a word wall for them, and then rhythm, what would that be? Think of, and then timbres could be all the different items when you're choosing instruments. There's so many ways for them to make sense of this, plus provide content-specific academic vocabulary that would really take this into a learning realm. And then they're going to be fluid with knowing the platform, as well as knowing that they are seeing the academic and using the musical terms with it as well. That would be cool.
And I adore you. You're content-specific academic.
Thank you.
All of this.
Exactly. Lingo.
That's right. But again, I mean, this, you know, so I would always say this is a good way to get started quickly, because, you know, it takes the stress out of learning how to use Noteflight. You can even gamify, you know, whoever could make a score that uses every single element, that would be really fun. If you can do it, we'd love to see it, right? We have these test scores that use every possible element. And every time we do something, change the site, we re-render them and compare them and make sure they look the same. That's kind of how we test. So we have some, they're not that pretty, but if someone could make a beautiful musical score that uses every possible Noteflight element, we'd love to have it.
You know what, the great thing about this is gonna help create meaning for students, especially if you invite them to write a couple sentences about it. Like, when I added the crescendo, this is what was gonna happen. Before, this is what happened. So it's almost like a compare contrast opportunity. And I know that there's so many possibilities to write about music. And given the fact the students can actually hear it and see it, it would be a really good example and some fodder for them to write about it in a concrete way.
And I just, as you were talking, I started adding that as a comment. Every Noteflight score has this comments panel, so students can give you their comments and you can comment back with text. Or obviously, if you're using Google or some other learning management system, you could have a discussion opened up in there. It's totally flexible, but it's kind of cool to put comments in the score, because if students want to like share their thoughts, that's really good. Also, there's a description of every score, so students could also describe their work in the description section.
That's great.
For this work, I did da 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 da, and so that way it has this like really cool description as well. All right.
What about shifting this a little bit? What if we invite the students to use the text format of this and they get to write the counts of the rhythms underneath the notes and the silences?
Absolutely. We use that a lot. So text is great for that, and that's T. So you can hit any note and just hit T for text. Another thing that helps with that is lyrics. So if you use text and you just use lyrics, I mean, you can write lyrics, but also it's Command L, but I'll just kind of get started and just put one here so you can kind of see what I'm talking about. How do you use Noteflight? So I can use lyrics. The cool thing about lyrics is once you're entering them, you could hit like spacebar to tab over, and actually, hey, I know how rhythm works. This is actually 4, 1, 3, 4, 1. So I could do the counts of the beat. These could be fingerings. These could be solfege, you know, filling in. So you can use the lyric feature, and it's really easy because with lyrics you can use the space bar to go note to note, which is a little easier. So
John, before we leave that, can you look at that first measure? It says 1. Can you put like 1-2 without it jumping to count 3?
Actually, probably no, because it probably thinks it's going to be a hyphen. So you might have to do something like that, which probably looks like a half. You'd have to be a little, maybe 1.2 or something.
That would be great.
Hyphen is a very specific lyric tool, so it's going to want to think it's another one.
Cool.
But you
That's
could
great because you can see those numbers.
Yep, and you can always use T for text on everything else. And again, you know, if you really want to do, I will mention, if anyone's looking for like really like high analysis, you can also use the chord symbol feature. And with chord symbols, they will recognize figured bass as well. So if you were to type, I'll just do a 1, 6, 4 or something, whatever a chord will be, it will recognize figured bass as well if you want to go that far. I don't know how much figured bass you want your kids writing, but you can also have them write chords and everything else in here. All right. Let's record. This is the next one I'm super excited about. Okay. We've made enough mess of Brahms. Poor Brahms. Sorry, Brahms. So now I'm going to go back in the library and we're going to talk about recording on Noteflight, because this is where it gets awesome. Now, everyone that has an extended demo of Noteflight Learn now has access to every content library. So we have these additional libraries of actual like HowlLeonard content that we've put in. And let's go to the POP library and let's look for something that we could use to get going with. Now there's there is 381 POP songs in here and different genres. I'm gonna select show tunes, because anyone that knows me is know that my entire inner dialogue is musical theater. There's all sorts of cool stuff in here. What do we have? Oh, Think of Me. Perfect. So I'm gonna pull up this POP song. We have the full pop song. I'm going to check out a copy. And again, your students can just freely access and find these as well. So they can use these just to play at home. But let's say they want to record. Well, we can play along. We can listen to the playback. Or we can record. So if you ever wanted to know why I was a trumpet player, you're about to find out.
Wait, that whole hand's coming up again, that whole stop sign.
It was a high five, right? But I can just record. Think of me fondly when we've said goodbye. Remember, sorry, and my inner Christine there. So your students can literally, I mean, I'm on a webinar doing this. You just hit record and you go and it picks up the mic. This works on Chromebook, Mac, or PC. It's great. And suddenly the student can hear themselves play. Now, obviously they want to use headphones so they don't get all the feedback like I was getting, but for demonstration purposes, recording opens up like 600 lesson ideas, which Anne's going to say all 600 in the next 60 seconds.
Okay, just really quick note. In the upper left-hand corner of that sheet music, you see an orange dot, and that means that something's been recorded on it. So that's good to know, too, when you see that pop up. Okay, obviously, record a pop song. Oh, my gosh, what if you change the lyrics and add your own lyrics? What if you create a rap over it and add those lyrics? What if you create a dictation assignment so that they have to find the melody within that? Maybe you could send a friend the bass line, invite them to compose their own melody with it. Or you can add a melody. Again, every 8 measures, pass the score on to someone else and invite them to add it on. So much to do with this recording that you can actually create large extensions that can go across many students. You can also invite students to practice instrument notation. You can notate any scale on the doc 2 times, one after another, and invite students to play and record over the first scale. And whenever you're recording, they get to do a compare contrast of, okay, I played my scale this time this way, and then the second time I played it this way. A great opportunity to record, let's pretend it's a scale or a song, doesn't matter what it is. Whatever they want to record. They listen to it, they play it the first time, and then they really fine-tune their listening about intonation. And they can tell if they're maybe flat or sharp, and they can, in their notes, you know, make notes of what note they played, too flat or too sharp. Like maybe John sang every note flat, then he would get to go back and record it again. And then really look at how he could sing with all the notes in tune and what he has to do with his body and have him reflect on his body to play in tune. Or if he was playing the trumpet and it was all too sharp. I don't know.
All sorts of options. I'm making up all kinds of crazy lyrics as you go. Yeah, you could rewrite lyrics. You can play. But, you know, play with this music. There's so many different ways you can do this. We'll talk about recording now for the rest of the lessons. There's all sorts of things you can do with recording. The other thing I always want to mention with recording is that you can remove notes, right? So this can become a dictation exercise, right? You can record and then remove the notes, and students have to go back and compose the melody from what they hear.
Actually, John, that would be a great memorization technique too.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Make them do it that way. So tons of recording. So recording has all sorts of options. And again, you have these pop songs that you can use for that. So I'm going to save this monstrosity and let's go back to adapting existing content. So here's the other tip. Also using content libraries. Let me open up a new tab here because we're getting messy, which is fun. You have band, choir, orchestra, guitar, piano. So all of this can be used as is to play and record along. I mean, that alone will keep your students engaged for the next 4 years. But let's think about how we can adapt some of this, right? So anything that already exists, I'm going to go in piano, and I'm going to grab maybe like an easy piano solo or something like that. I'm going to pick one of these randomly. Ooh, hunting horns. That seems fun. I don't know what hunting horns is. Great, this is a good one. So very simple little melody, right? Now, this could be something piano students could play. You could take this and adapt it in different keys. So students can maybe practice playing in different keys. But what if I did this? What if I just went through and took this and deleted the melody and kept the bass line? And now I've immediately created a composition exercise where students can go in and compose a melody along with an existing bass line. Right? super easy. You've adapted something and now students have an activity right away.
Yeah. So I'm going to tag on with that one because you could even like look at the next section. You know how the melody still exists. You could invite the students to begin some score analysis for the older students where they can analyze the pitches and then they write in what the chords are and then they can add melody to it. So maybe they can understand how to fall within the chord tones of the piece itself.
Oh, you know what, Anne? I will show you. There's lots of ways. So the choral music's fun for that too, right? So that would take like some of this existing choir stuff in here. And that's when you have all of them. I mean, here's all of me three part. Even something like that can be analyzed with piano and different parts.
Yeah.
Right?
That'd be great.
You have a solo part. Now, when it breaks into the SATB, let me check this out.
Sweet.
What if you just gave me an idea? So now we have a melody with piano in a very popular song, but what if we let students take their shot at you seeing their harmony? So now I'm going to take the existing SAB with the solo and we're just going to delete this, right? And that way, now I've created an opportunity for students to complete an SAB arrangement along with a melody and piano part that exists. And I'm just going to delete, delete. Ta-da!
You know what? This is a great way to practice improvisation. Oh my gosh. Because sometimes, you know, we want that chord structure behind us to hear, and students are, you know, they don't have that backtrack at home. But wow, if they have the chord structure for improv.
Really, you know what, Anne? We could do this. We could go parts and we could keep the piano. I mean, the other cool thing about Noteflight is we can just turn off the other parts. So now here's the piano part alone. And they can go in and record themselves again. And you could turn off the audio from everything but the piano. So check this out, turning off the audio. And now what you'll see is, I'm just gonna go da 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 da. Now I can play in here on the piano. And I can record myself with it. What you'd like to do, what you could do is maybe turn back on maybe just the soprano line if you want, but turn the audio off. So I'll go back to parts, turn my solo back on. So now I've created solo and piano, and then I'll go back into record mode. And now, again, if you'd like you said, if this is an improvisation thing, you could just delete the solo line, right? Let's just delete this flat out. But give students a line to improvise with. And now, empty staff, and sorry, I'm an obsessive saver. And now students can just sing and improvise along right with the melody here. Right?
Hey, John, would there be like, could you do repeat signs? So the music would go back and forth in a four chord structure or in an eight measure structure?
Of course, you can add repeats,
yeah.
Absolutely. So you could just take one section for eight bars and just let kids go through. You can do first, second, third, fourth, fifth endings, and Noteflight will just loop.
Indeed. Nice.
You could put ending like 1, 2, 3, 4, and just that would make it, you can make it repeat multiple times by putting a repeat ending and numbered.
Love it.
I love it.
You know, if you change the articulation and you change dynamics, this is a great opportunity for students to look at what exists in the music and how the music would change if it's shifted with expressive elements for sure. Again, you can invite the students to write in the counts, especially on some of the accompaniment parts with syncopation. That's really key for them. I have seen high school kids struggle with rhythm writing and counting, so it's important they always reiterate that. Sometimes they listen to a pop song, and they think, oh, I've got it because they've heard it. They really don't know the internal counts. And again, invite students to maybe even create a percussion part to it. Why not? Change it up.
I love it. Okay, so now tip six. Now tip six, let's go back and just start with something straight up from scratch, right? So let's talk about composition prompts. And this is unlocked. So I'm going to go to create. I'm going to make something from scratch, right? Treble clef sounds great, right? We don't want to do anything for low brass players or any low woodwinds. I mean, bass clef, uninvited, right? This party is nothing but treble.
No. Boom. I got that.
Just stop.
Yeah.
Stop. We'll call this stop making jokes. John, here we go. Here's a great score. So we'll call this stop making jokes, John. Now, there's a good opportunity to, like, let's say we want students to do a pentatonic lesson. Let's give them four notes as a prompt, right? maybe we're gonna do C, which I'll just type here. I'm just typing the letters on my keyboard, D, F, G. Let's use these, in fact, let's make it simple. So there's four notes you're gonna use to compose. So what I'm gonna do is quickly hit return and get this staff all in one system. And I will show you this technique to set up your templates for this. Now, I'm persnickety, so I'm gonna put a final bar line here. And then I'm gonna go select the measure below, and I'm gonna add text block before the system. So it puts this big old text block here, and you can say using the pitches above, write a melody that prevents John from making bad jokes.
There we go.
Here it is. Prevents John. And I'm going to put an exclamation point because that makes it fun. And if you even want to be extra persnickety, I'll make this measure one. So you see how I've created the separation of prompt and exercise. And again, I'll just add another measure so you have four. I just use the R key. You know, you can always R, repeat whatever you want. I can break this automatically into two. So there we go. Eight measure melody based on a four note prompt.
So about we could, and this would be great for beginners. Let's pretend they only know two notes, C and D. Let's pretend they're working through the pentatonic, C, D, E, G, A, pentatonic on C. Think of, or depends on maybe whatever scale they're working on for improv, for jazz. The whole goal is for them to start beginning to compose and then understand it. And once they compose, invite them also to write the counts underneath it and then play it back. Maybe even they could clap the rhythm of the piece and then they could play the piece itself.
That's a great use of an accordion, actually, clap the rhythm.
Yeah, because then you're gonna get some really great assessment opportunities. So what if you put out this melody that they're working on the notes that they're working on as well, and then you're inviting them to compose and then play that back to you. So you could assess the rhythm and then you could focus on the pitch or vice versa.
I love it. One of the things that will help here is you get more pitches or more prompts is you can go to measure and just change the time signature. Like if this is pentatonic, I'll make it 5/4. If you want, you can also hide the time signature. So you'll see it shows the 4/4 here, but now I can make this like a pentatonic reference, right? So we can give it ta-da. We'll make this, maybe do ta-da. Oops, let's go down here, ta-da. And we can just go, we can make it, you know, a five note pattern. You can add more notes as you need to. These can also be rhythm prompts as well. It can be a half note, a quarter, and 2/8. And those are the only rhythms you can use. Lots of option.
And you can write those in. This is my last tip for this before we move to tip 7. And that is, what if you take either a melody that the kids know from their music or a melody that's public domain like Twinkle Twinkle, and you put it in the first measures instead of that scale, you're going to put it, but you're going to place it in out of order. And then you're going to ask the students to put the measures back in order. And the order, the longer the melody is, probably the older the student. But think about some of the great tunes that they're playing right now. And maybe they're not always getting the melodic lines, so they don't really focus on that. So this is a great chance for them to understand that as well. Kind of a puzzle, kind of a game.
I love this, Anne. So what she just said is duh. And we can do, how easy is Noteflight? My gosh, that took 2 seconds. So now right. What I would do if I was a teacher is I'd write it in order. And then what I would do is maybe copy this measure and put it first. And then I'll copy the last measure, put it maybe third, copy the first measure, put it last, copy the second measure, put it second. So I just copy and paste it. Now I've made it out of order, right? And now I'm just gonna actually straight up delete all of this to get rid of it. And so that's exactly, I've just quickly made what Anne says. So now we can remove, you see I'm using a little minus sense to remove each measure. And now my prompt is an out of order thing. So now I'm gonna shift select, repeat the whole thing and say, help, it's broken. Put it in order by copy and pasting.
I love that. That could be, and that would be like a great teaser to get kids online. Hey, my melody's out of order. If you can put it back in order, email me and let me know, or text in the thread once you have it.
You know what I love about this is because it's an extension. Like if you have a composition exercise where a student takes a prompt and writes an eight measure melody, then the next extension we now get it out of order and see if the student can listen to the first melody as an audio file and put it in order in the next one.
Yeah, they could even like, they could do student assignments like, here's my main melody, give it to their peer, and then their peer has to put it back in order, and then they send them another one. So you could do some partner work there.
This is so much fun. I love it. So this is incredible. I mean, there's so many. We've already, Anne, in the first six tips, we've given like 1,232 lessons and like 2.5 years of distance learning.
We have four more to go to. This is amazing. Okay, let's go to tip seven, using colors with tip seven.
Coloring, I mean, so we have this color palette down here, and you can activate it, and you'll see that it extends. So there's the basic colors, and then there's an extension. The extension is classroom colors. These may or may not be the exact same colors as Boomwhacker colors and other. So they also have the letter names. So immediately, you can have reinforced note reading by having students color the notes correctly. One thing I would do if I was doing this copy and paste thing is you could even color each measure a different color. If I really did this, I would try to do like Roy G. Biv in order or something. But then when they copy and paste it, it copies and pastes in the correct with the colors. So you'll be able to see like how they put it in order, you know, just as an extension, like as a copy and paste. So there's also a color element here, right?
Yeah, and let me just address two things on the educational side of this. One, believe it or not, there are students that don't see some colors well. They're not even colorblind, but they learn better with like a color screen over their paper. And that might already be in their educational individualized education plan, their IEP. But two would be if you do have students that are colorblind, just make sure you know those students and who they are. And that would be important for them so they can have access to that as well. Some kids just love color because it entices them to work. Like they would color code in different on highlighter on their own music. So color is also fantastic when you're looking at a score and you want to address form, you know, or where the main melody is. What do you have there, John? You have a full score up?
Yeah, so while you're done, I pulled up a full band score from the band content library. This is a grade one level Let It Go from Frozen, obviously. So, I mean, first of all, how cool is it for kids to be able to, like, see full band scores and interact? But what if we did an exercise where we colored the melody blue, we colored the harmony green, right? We colored all the trombone parts red because they're bad, right? So we could just do something like that. So again, it's another use of color is interacting with these full scores and color coding the different elements. That's obviously more advanced, but certainly applicable.
Yeah, and then maybe if you do one's just the melodic line, then they could see where the melodic line is handed off throughout the score.
Exactly.
That'd be creating right? like a, it's almost like a search for the melodic line in a score versus us telling it where it is. We invite them to listen for it in even fragments of the melody. Hey, and then one last thing before we go on to tip eight, you know, these all align with the Boomwhackers. John, tell us more.
Right. So you can even create exercise with those color codes. You could have students write music and then apply the correct color for that for Boomwhackers. Or if you know, you happen to have the Boomwhackers at home, kids could write things for you and you would play it for them and make videos of yourself playing them to send them back to the students. They could hear the teacher make the composition because all of you want to record and play 30 Boomwhacker compositions for your students.
But you know, now that you said that, John, every time that a student does something and they send it back to you, wouldn't it be great for them to know that at least once you've played their piece back and recorded it for them?
Right. And if you know, a lot of the Noteflight users for the distance learning have full district implementations. And the beautiful thing about that is your middle school, your elementary students can write something, but the high schoolers could go in and record it for them, right? So if you really have, you know, you could work together in your district and have high school students record things that middle schoolers have composed. It can be, you know, seventh graders have to write a sight reading for the high schoolers to keep them engaged and they have to record it in one take. And then, so there's so many ways to collaborate and share, which is really great.
As we move to tip eight, you just hit something that's so important. The cool thing about this learning from home and this e-learning is that we get to really erase school walls. So erase them, right? Let's get out there and contact your peer and go, hey, my kids are writing melodies. Can your band students at your school do it? Why not create this cross lines? It's about time that we stop thinking about just as our individual students and start thinking larger. Oh my gosh, what about our Noteflight community in the United States? I think I would like some Noteflight pen pals in New Jersey. Why not, right?
I love it. Noteflight pen pals. I love it. We're going to take that up right away. So now, next tip, probably should have come earlier, but now it's all about rhythm, right? Let's talk about rhythm, right? And actually, I love something you just said, which was beautiful. It was erase the classroom walls, right? That, I mean, we have the opportunity to share. So we're going to go with that title, erase the classroom walls. Sorry, I am so persnickety. If it's not in title case, I will just can't handle. So now let's you know what? I'm a fan of just capitalizing everything. You know, A, the of. Are you a capitalize everything? Are you a keep the V and the A?
Yeah, I'm so worried about my people judging me on my grammar already. So I don't know.
No, right? Anyway, I mean, there's 313 people still watching. So we're being judged on everything, my sweet friend.
You know it.
Okay, so now let's talk about percussion. We need to talk about making percussion parts. So I'm going to change this instrument, and I'm just going to go and find the drum set, which is unpitched percussion, right? And we do standard drumming. And now you have this opportunity to do a drum set. Now, one thing that students may not realize is every, you know, though there's technically a percussion clef, every line and staff has a standard sound. There's a standard drum mapping that exists for music notation. So you could just use the arrow key with the note and hear all the sounds.
Oh, this is like a timbre study, John. So they could identify which instrument it is. Do it again for me.
And honestly, they can just do this. Drum solo.
That's right.
So they might start off as simple as like, oh, that's a low sound. Oh, that's a percussion. That's a snare sound. You know, so you can alternate here. We can add a note. I'm going to add the F here. So now they can make even eighth notes, very simple drum beats, right? So they can do variations, make that back a quarter note. So you have this. And then the other thing that's a great variation on drum beats is just adding a rest, you know, and in fact, repeating this measure and then making a quick variation and suddenly, or deleting, I'll do this one more time, repeat and delete. And then you have like a little bit of a drum beat starting from the beginning.
Then we get some rhythm patterns that are going to really support the pulse, and the students can then really help understand rhythm too, as well as you could write the rhythm, the counts underneath the rhythm.
Right. Hear the different variations of a drum beat. And again, check it out. Once you get a little pattern going, you can easily shift select, and repeat, right? Just repeat the pattern. Now, I want to talk about multiple voices, because this is how you do different layers in Noteflight. So you go down to voice, and we can add an upper voice. And you see that it immediately adds an upper voice. So that's how we get two different rhythms. Again, if you're just in one voice, it's going to make you have the same rhythm so you can make chords. But if you flip to two voices, this is where you add your, and so I'm just going to add like a closed hi-hat. So now I'm going to use the R key for repeat and go, oops, it did not go into upper voice in the second measure. So we're going to slow that down a little bit. Let's try this again, folks. Let's go in the second measure, hit U for upper voice, and let's add this note again. And we're going to add it in, and we're going to do that every time just to make sure. So you can click a measure. Noteflight L is lower voice, U is upper voice. So I'm just going to hit U and add in my little notes. Cha 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 cha. Now we go over here and hit U and go hit my note. Now, the cool thing is, the way I'm doing this quickly is it still responds to the letter names of treble clef. So when I want to add this note, I'm just hitting G, the G key, and it knows it's there. So once you kind of get the hang of that, it'll be pretty easy to do it. So now we have a little bit funkier beat. And I can go in and fix this beaming too if we need to.
Yeah, I love that. The beaming is so important, I think, with all students, for them to realize that we're doing beat inclusive notation, so they understand where the rhythm falls within the beat. and that it helps support any students who are having troubles tracking. This is fantastic because you can also record a wrap over something like this. You could spend this time and really support everyone to understand what is a traditional rock backbeat sound like and what is it done. You could really study all the different genres of percussion of music that the drummer, the drum kit player would play, and then let even the band members know that, oh my gosh, this drummer has got to learn all these different styles and this is how it's different. So I don't think this is only just for a drummer. I think this is for all instrumentalists who are playing in an ensemble, and it helps them find themselves within the piece.
Also, well, what you want to be a drummer.
Yeah, everyone wants to be a drummer, but they can't. So it's good for them to see how hard it is, right?
Yeah, some of us have to do math and make an income. So it's,
oh, you know. My gosh. John, we're going to lose some people here. Stop that. Okay, here's the next thing you can do.
They do it on their computers.
You could create a duet between percussion parts. So if it were a single drum line, you could then have another drum line underneath it, and they could do this complete four measure rhythmic complementary duet.
Right. You know what, Anne? That's a really great idea. Obviously, because for some students, the upper lower voice thing can be a little confusing at first. So yeah, it's probably easier to just start by adding like three or four drum lines, and just you could actually create a two part drum thing by using two independent lines. That's probably easier. And you could actually add a third layer or a fourth layer or a fifth layer of all sorts of different rhythms. That's probably an easier way to start.
You know, and actually in high school, when I was teaching composition with students, I asked them to do it separately with the first assignment so they could see where it fall. And then they got added in. It helped break it down. Hey, John,
right.
I'm looking
at my layer in too.
I'm thinking we should move ahead to tip 9 to sync a video because it's the coolest thing ever.
All right, so now we have all these tools, right? And you'll see this is kind of getting progressive. So like at the end, you can make lessons with all these elements. Now, sync a video. Noteflight can sync YouTube, or really any hosted audio, but YouTube is the easiest to go with, to a score. So I'm gonna go back to this Think of Me. Now this is a mess. So what I'm gonna do is use my Noteflight versioning, and I'm gonna go back to version 1. I bet you didn't know that you can restore previous versions of anything. So, I can quickly go back to where I started. I'm actually going to get rid of my audio. So now we're back to square one of Think of Me, right? Now, the Noteflight sounds are, in fact, beautiful. But what if I pulled up the YouTube video of this and I copied the link? There is a feature called Sync Audio, and it's right here. It's in the score menu. So I'll use the prompt here called Sync Audio, and it's going to pull up the sync audio panel. I load my audio source. This also works with any hosted audio. So if it's an MP3 from SoundCloud or any link to a audio source, it will work with. Now, what you're gonna do is you can actually teach Noteflight how to follow the video. So I'm gonna hit play. Now I can use the measure button or I can use the M key on my computer. It's a little bit easier to use the M key. So let's just sync up a little bit so I could just show you how this works. So I'm going to hit play.
Andre, this is doing nothing for my nerves.
Think of me.
So I'm tapping each measure.
Think of me fondly when we've said goodbye.
You'll see the cursor's kind of memorizing the tempo.
Remember me once in a while. Please promise me you'll try.
So you have to go through the whole thing. I will tell you, just having students tap each measure along with the recording with the music, for a lot of them, again, for an elementary kid, that's tricky. For a middle school trombone player, that's hard. For a high school percussionist, it's even harder, right? So like, you know, having them just find the rhythm is really, really, really important. Oh, you know what?
They're really, you know, John, they're using such major auditory discrimination skills right now, because what they're really doing is having to focus on a pulse, find an internal pulse within them and see it aligned. So they're really having to focus on some great skills.
And you know what? I feel bad. You know, I've left out your viola players. This is perfect for your viola players too. I mean, I've left the string players out. Strings are just as important in all the jokes. So now when I play this, it actually, the playback of the score is synced. You can even skip ahead and it aligns with the video. I'll show you one last cool thing is that you can minimize the video if you'd like to just hear the playback. Or you can actually have the video come up full screen. You can actually in Noteflight expand the size of the video or minimize it just by dragging. So I'll show you one more thing. If I go from page view to strip view, check it out. Now I've created the melody scrolling with the video, and now
Andre, this is doing nothing for my nerves.
Now I could audio record myself singing that part, and then you would hear a recording of me singing along with the YouTube video. You could compose to film. I could completely turn off the YouTube audio and just use the Noteflight audio and have it all sync up. And do you have like 87 more ideas on this?
I have. Yeah, let me give you at least a couple. The great thing, oh my gosh, it's like a perfect masterclass for your students. So get a piece of music they're learning that you've heard a professional sing. Invite them to sync that in there, and then they can follow this along and replicate the technique that the singer or that the musician is doing, the instrumentalist is doing. A great opportunity also to like listen and pull apart what a guitar player might have done with a standard piece, you know? So maybe there's some solos happening. You can listen to that as well.
I love it. So a student can find an etude or some piece of music, find a video of someone playing that, sync the video of their model, and then play along right in Noteflight with their model and the music at the same time.
Right. And you know what will happen? It's going to push them in deliberate practice so that they're not stopping and starting and stopping and starting. They're going to have to run alongside that bus to make sure they stay in time with it.
I love it.
This is a great opportunity also for students at any age level, because I've had my third graders do compare contrast. How did the composer of this video and how did the performer of this video perform these measures? Then you share them another link. How did the composer or the performer of this video share these measures? So maybe it's the same piece, different versions, and they can compare contrast. A lot of students like to see the video.
I think this is brilliant. So I'm going to jump to our last tip, which is right. We've been hitting on it the whole time, but the most important thing with all these lessons is students can share with each other and just use Noteflight to make copies and copies and copies of lessons. You do not have to, once you make one lesson, that becomes a template for so many different things you've done, right? So if you've started with just a two-part percussion, save a copy, and this is suddenly can be your two-part percussion template. So as you make these lessons in Noteflight for the first time and you set up the two parts, you could just quickly and say, you know what, let me just do myself a favor, two-part perk template, and just save this for yourself, right? And this becomes a template. You can pull this up again, make another copy, and then use it. So you know, make sure you think of methodically about how you could use and make copies and copies of copies. If you have an existing lesson that you want to do an extension on, you don't have to restart it. Make a copy of something that's there. And then importantly, have students share. Students could write two measures, make a copy, and then share with another student. And then they could write a measure, then they can make a copy and share with someone else. So make a copy, share it, send it to each other. How, you know, the world's biggest game of telephone, every student composes a measure, share your score, add your measure, make a copy, share it with someone else, and then you see the full thing at the end.
And what a great way to engage everyone. Plus, also, what a great opportunity now for us to invite students to show us applications of everything they've learned. So maybe it's about eighth notes and 16th notes, and they compose something and they share what they've learned. They're applying their knowledge versus just we assume that they might have it. Then what you could also do is, again, invite your older students in the district or your older students in your school to create for other people. Invite your students to create worksheets or music on terms and theory that you're learning and teaching. If you have AB and IP or IB students and AB students, invite them to practice all the textures they need to know, monophony, homophony, heterophony, all those big terms that sometimes they think they get, but when push comes to shove, they're not able to really demonstrate it. So this is great real world opportunity to learn about these things. And all of this expands their listening. All of this expands who they are as a musician. And they see themselves as a creator versus I'm just playing. This just playing concept is too narrow now that we have these incredible platforms like Noteflight.
And this is incredible. As you were talking, I went through the questions because I can see the questions. Overall, they like us. They really like us. There's lots of praise here, which is wonderful. You like me? You really like me? Maybe it's all for you, man. It probably is.
No.
I'm sure. So here's as far as some more really specific detailed questions, you can always email us info@noteflight.com or support@noteflight.com. We'll help you out. But as a bonus, here's some more tips. I'm going to, you know, happen to just scroll over this pre-made done window of all these additional ideas, happen to have it up, NBD. Notes.noteflight.com is our blog. Many of you have seen our distance learning support page. We've spun this up. This is how you probably get access to Noteflight Learn through our demo request. In addition, we've relisted all the various articles. There's another webinar. We'll put this webinar on top. But I want to pay a particular attention to our support center, our free lesson plan database, our teacher tutorials, and our student lesson videos. And then we also have podcasts and additional articles that are helpful. But the support center is the one that I think is really ideal, because several people have asked about how do I set up with Google? You said Google. How do I do Google? Look, check it out. If you go to support.noteflight.com, here's Noteflight Learn. Oh, site setup. Set up with Google right here. Initial site setup walks you through step-by-step instructions on how to set up and do assignments with Google. There's all different categories you can go through and see. Anything that involves Google says it specifically. If it doesn't have any specific mention, then it applies to everything. But you can also just search and say, you know, show me everything with Google. And I can search the Help Center, and here's all your Google integration. So this Help Center is completely searchable. It has articles, pictures, a really great resource. This lesson plan resource has over 100 lesson plans that are ready to go. You see how fast I'm scrolling through them? So hundreds of lessons. You can search by name. You can sort by level. Show me upper elementary lessons, grades 3 through 5, 43 lessons ready to go, right? You can also sort by standard. If I'd like to do standard 3, refine and create, so there's 48 lessons that covered standard 3. You can take these lessons straight up and use them. You can open, everyone has a Noteflight score. And these are all teacher given. So if you have your own lessons, share with us too. This is a resource for teachers, by teachers, and it's really, really great stuff. All the tutorial videos we mentioned, all of these videos are exist to help you learn to use Noteflight, so you can watch these. And we've also, since the school closures, we spun up a new playlist where we've made and we're collecting videos of that teachers have already made, because many of us have made, hey student, here's how to do this lesson videos. So we're compiling all of these, so you have a video that you could use right away. So again, here's an overview of how to get started with Noteflight directed to students that you could share as a first lesson. Or like I said, making a mess, a great assignment to just get used to using the editor. So you could literally say, hey, here's your lesson, go to Noteflight and here it is. These are pre-done for you so you can get started right away using Noteflight.
Wow, John, so many tips. Thanks so much. I've learned a lot watching, but as we were both talking, I have even more ideas. And I know that the ideas that exist out there in this world, it's exponential. I can't wait to see everything that people are going to share with you.
Well, I think one of the great things about what I always learn from you, Anne, and what I think everyone that on the watching the webinars is going to keep learning, is that as soon as you just get in and do a few things with Noteflight and you get students' feedback and you see what they do, the first thing you do, you'll think of 4 more ideas. And then the third thing you do, you'll think of 10 more ideas. And it's exponential growth. And once you get into it, you're like, ooh, I just thought about 20 other things to do. And it's not a what do I start, it's what do I even do next, because there's so many ideas.
Yeah, and I want to add one more thing before we leave. This is such a perfect opportunity for us to back away and not be completely directive in everything that we give, so that students have the opportunity to create. This is about creation. It's about a fluidity of their ideas with a platform that is really user-friendly. So I encourage you to support that personalized learning element in this and see what the students can give to you as well and to the entire class.
Awesome. And I cannot thank you enough for joining and sharing your incredible wisdom with all of us. You are wonderful, and I appreciate you so very much.
Right back at you, John.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.